To be born in Vienna means music and art were already installed in your wits from the start. You grew up among concerts, museums and talk, where you gently converse and invent as you walk, where the streets are arranged as a theatre or stage with an intimate link to the pen and the page, where composer, philosopher, painter and bard would develop their thinking of global regard, and where people contributed patient attention to others who challenged accepted convention. The streets and apartments were charmed by a thrill that engages the world of intelligence still. Conversation was everything. All of the streets, the cafes and the opera, the pastries and sweets, had the sole dedication of making a space for enhancing the social with comfort and grace, to make keen conversation with maximum ease, so that thoughts could meander wherever they please, and to stimulate each interlocutor more than had ever been heard in all talking before. In the 30s, this paradise faltered and crashed. Liberality, thinking, and poems were trashed as the Nazis swept in with their odious views to humiliate, trap, and exterminate Jews. You escaped with your mother, your uncle as well, and your grandmother, inches from plunging to hell, and arrived in Australia, in Melbourne, in fact, whose contingent of Hebrews was never attacked. It was peaceful and fair with intelligent folk, who in those days were known as the Missus and Bloke. You attended a state school, learnt English so well that in listening I wouldn't be able to tell that it wasn't a native command. You read Keats, you read Milton with comfort as one of your feats, and admired the intensity, colour and sense that the language projects as sublime and immense. And where Shakespeare bewildered your classmates at school, you adroitly connected the savant and fool. The irrational frenzy with language and sense that the bard intellectually holds in suspense. The seduction of metaphor filled you with joy in the wayward expressions that poets employ, and the plots, the design, and the shrewd observations that writers record from their peregrinations, the wit, the ideas, and the cheeky belief that a logical argument thrives on relief, interjection and drama, some chaos, some spice, or the changes of diction that dramatists splice. It was humour, however, that moved you the most, where you'd sit with a comedy, wholly engrossed, and regale us with laughter in generous peals, from the belly to high in the gullet in squeals. You adored how a thought can be bent to a joke, with absurdity's mad paradoxical stroke, how it tickles the fancy by things that go wrong, and the meaning resides where it doesn't belong. It was surely the virtue and source of appeal that made Peter so suitable, warm and ideal. This most jocular Peter, your husband-to-be, with a wit that inspired the most humorous glee. To be funny for you was a passport at home. It's the spark in a room that allows us to roam, to extend our perception from where we abide to the other unknown and unreachable side. It's a freedom with wisdom that parleys with folly, for nonsense to rage in a copious volley, yet somehow arrive at a sensible point that connects what is crazily still out of joint. The adorable Peter possessed this ability, flexing his words with a brainy agility, practicing nonsense with witty intent that his ludicrous fancies would madly invent. But the meaning inhered in the crazy conceit that alone recommended the lucid and sweet. Because this was the catch, in that Peter appealed for the sense that his nonsense profoundly revealed. You were taken by science, by reason and wit. If your heart had a rubric, then surely that's it. You were brilliant with science and maths from the start, where the labour of reason extended your heart. It belongs to a rationalist, visionary frame for benignly advancing the intellect's claim. To increase understanding already in youth, for enhancing society's stake in the truth. It was chemistry first, where you boosted the search in advancing the glorious course of research, with the honour of gaining the first PhD as a woman at Melbourne to get the degree. And thereafter you published in journals as well, where your sharp analytical mind would excel. You were taken by industry. Science is great, and a chemist needs problems and jobs to create. In industrial settings, the problems abound, where ingenious deliverables need to be found. You were perfectly formed to assist in the charge and to tackle the exigent problems at large, with the chemistry centred on critical questions to which you'd supply scientific suggestions. As a mum, your incisive and logical brain was equipped to correct, to refute, and explain. But it wasn't your style to confront and attack or exploit what your young interlocutors lack. You were gifted in listening, to listen and hear. What I struggled to think and express and make clear was a composite gift of affection and brains that a parent might wish for but seldom attains. You encouraged whatever I wanted to tell. You'd inhabit wherever my ramblings would dwell. There was nothing so minor or boyish or quaint that resulted in boredom or caused a complaint. All my infantile fantasies drew you along like the frivolous words of an innocent song, where the words are a joke to amuse and rehearse, and the music redeems every trivial verse. It was only with maths that impatience was heard. To mistake mathematics to you seemed absurd, as the problem in question is easy, not tough, and in stumbling you haven't been thinking enough. It was simple for you, and to miss the ideas was perhaps to succumb to irrational fears, inhibitions that weakened a sharp concentration that yields both the answer and charm and elation. It's logical, clear, and with infinite use. And to fail, there could hardly be any excuse. But for everything else, you had patience in spades. It remains where the memory of formulae fades. You were brilliant at listening, in taking it in, by the relative weight of the deep and the thin. With apparently bland, insignificant things, you would wait for suggestions that fantasy brings. to extrapolate sense from the dull naive that a mind at its sharpest could barely conceive. You could see that a silly or premature whim had a charm that was thrilling, not stupid and dim, that it sprang from a fantasy keen to create, to unlock the opaque and inhibiting gate, and to nourish the nonsense to grow and mature for the sake of a mind that's inventive and pure. This indulgence in listening to nonsense was great, to encourage the confidence nurtured in prate, and to aliment fantasy, freedom of thought, among feelings that can't be examined or taught, to establish the instinct to build a reality forged by a growing creative mentality. That was the generous gift that I treasure, that buttresses all of my labours and leisure. I borrow the innocence time and again in immersing the nib of my fanciful pen with its thirst for the liquor in generous supply that has never been emptied or stanched or run dry. It was more than a languishing poet could want, more complete than the sweet Heliconian font, because flowing with intimate family jokes in satirical shoes and theatrical cloaks. We made fun of ourselves in our habits and looks, in grandiloquent language from exquisite books. The most modest of things in the house had a name, from an object of museological fame. Unremarkable actions compared with the deeds that a scholar of epics or chivalry reads. If some gossip were heard, Marivaux was invoked, or the comical twists that Goldoni evoked. Or at work, an adroit, diabolical scene was explained by the nouns of the haughty Racine. In the garden for tea and for sunshine and air, the suburban backyard would become our parterre, like the grounds of a palace where poets might sing for the gentle contentment of nobles and king. An imaginary grove for a shepherd and flock that Marino might chant in the sanguine baroque, with a space of whatever unglamorous kind, a preposterous analogy soon came to mind, where archaic conceptions were called from the past for expanding the moment and making it last. This satirical pause has protracted my time in the glow of the image in meter and rhyme. How a fabled existence in oil paint or stone, or in verses, augments and reflects on our own by its difference, not likeness, to all that we know, in its lofty and grand, incommensurable glow. But we own it in ironies, ghettos and laughter, in pathos for what we may have and look after, the heirs and the riches, the privileged style with their highborn conventions, and enviable pile. My exceptional mother, you knew that our lot was to laugh at the things that are nebbish and not, to the actions and assets that fortune removes by the ditches of history's harrowing grooves, where experience scars and we trip in the rut, and we stagger where once we would swagger and strut. From the joys of Vienna, your fortunes were hurled from the axle that tempers the sway of the world. But you shouldered the shudders, the shout and the shove, to recover and spread the abundance of love. There is naught that I utter, contribute or do, where my confidence hasn't been owing to you. It's the love that I'll cherish for carrying on in the shadows of memory now that you're gone.